It all starts with the farmer, the ground, and the seed.
95% of the world's food comes from the Earth's topsoil. Every year, 27 billion tons of topsoil is forever destroyed. That means in just 60 years, the world could be unable to produce enough food to feed its ever-growing population. Plus, each year, the total number of acres available for cultivation gets smaller due to mismanagement, soil fatigue, and urban sprawl. It took billions of years for complex forces of nature to cover just 4% of the Earth's surface with topsoil rich enough to support plant life, and only a few hundred years of cultivation to destroy it.
We've been using the soil, plowing it, tilling it, growing food in it for a really, really long time. We've moved from the best agricultural lands into increasingly marginal lands.
We need to understand what we did in the past to make it better for the future.
In the next few minutes, we will examine the global topsoil problem and our search for solutions. But first, let's look at exactly how topsoil works and our history with it.
If everyone understands wine, right, the terroir, what you taste and what is inside that grape comes from the soil. It's no different with wheat, barley, canola, peas, lentils. All that nutrition is coming from the ground.
Topsoil begins as a powerful mixture of sand, silt, clay, and microscopic organisms.
Soil forms over hundreds to thousands of years. We tend to think of soil as a kind of an infinitely renewable resource, but it's not actually, because it takes that much time to form.
When organic matter blankets its surface, the organisms break it down to create humus, or nutrient-rich topsoil.
The soil is a poor man's rainforest, and it's got more biodiversity than any other part of the world anywhere. And a teaspoon of soil will have 15,000 species of bacteria alone, just in a teaspoon.
While these organisms work, the surface blanket of organic matter provides both protection from the force of raindrops and shade from the sun. This also holds in moisture and allows the newly created soil to breathe. Beneath its surface, small animals like earthworms tunnel to create tiny channels so water from above and minerals from below can reach new plant roots. The new plants grow to create more organic matter, and the natural cycle continues.
And plowing, tillage kind of chops all that up. It chops up fungal hyphae, it disrupts the natural functioning of the soil.
When humans first began to plant seeds, they tapped into this natural cycle. They simply poked a hole into the earth with a stick, inserted the seed, and closed the opening. Without realizing it, they had placed their seed in a near-perfect growth environment. It worked, naturally. But as populations grew, so did demand for food. More efficient planting techniques were needed.
As agricultural systems developed, there was a fair bit of soil disturbance that was going on in order to deal with residues and be able to get that seed into the ground.
In 1701, Jethro Tull, an English agriculturalist, developed the first mechanized seed drill, placing the seed in furrowed rows. Soon, other machines were developed, including the moldboard plow.
I think of it a little bit like a house of cards. When we till the soil, when we plow it, it's like breaking down that house of cards.
Designed specifically to raise the furrow and turn it over, this plow fully exposed the delicate topsoil layer to wind, rain, and sun.
And I think that's where we started to get ourselves into trouble.
By 1850, the John Deere Company was shipping 1,600 steel plows a year. All over the world, ranges and grasslands were put into food production. The planet's ability to feed itself doubled and redoubled over and over again. But something was wrong.
Millions of tons of sand and grit darkened the sky and smothered countless farms.
By the 1930s, after just 100 years of mechanized cultivation, the land had turned to dust.
You probably seen some articles back in the day of the Dirty 30s when the soil's blown across the prairies. That was a direct result of all the tillage that we were doing.
In desperation, the 1940s brought the soil conservation movement. But even with conservation, the topsoil itself was simply overworked and wearing out.
Because 70% of the nitrogen and phosphorus in a wheat crop is contained in the grain, which is harvested and removed entirely from the system. So a sustainable production system requires that those nutrients be replaced.
The canvas floating behind the boom duster helps confine the powder to give better coverage and better weed kill.
To help bring it back to life, fertilizers, pesticides, and herbicides were developed, and yields got bigger for a while. But the cost to produce each yield continued to rise. Fewer and fewer farmers were using larger and larger tractors to work bigger and bigger fields.
There was a real demand for increased production at that point in time throughout the world.
By the 1960s, the well-intentioned conservation practices of the 40s were all but abandoned, and the loss of topsoil accelerated.
To preserve that top 3-4 inches of soil, that is the lifeline of planet Earth, and as farmers, it's our duty to keep that soil healthy.
The problem, of course, was that the loss of the top layer of organic material also meant that the natural process that provides nutrients to the soil no longer functioned below the surface.
We've been using them intensively for so long that overall, the state of the world's soils is that they are degrading.
Something had to change. By the 1970s, North American farmers started to search for a better way. Their movement has become known as conservation tillage, or no-till.
It's not just no-till alone, but it was also the move away from fallow and monoculture to multi-crop rotations that included other crops as another means to add organic matter to the soil.
It worked. Costs went down, yields went up, and as a byproduct, the topsoil began to heal.
It's a soil-conserving system, but it provides a lot of other benefits as well that growers like, and that's led them to adopt it and stick with it.
Over the next several decades, the no-till movement would evolve and evolve again, each time strengthening the link between topsoil's natural abilities and sustainable farming practices.
So as soon as you can improve the health of that soil, those plants start to store more nutrient density inside their grains. And that's what we get to eat.
For more than 40 years, North American farmers developed and improved their conservation practices, allowing today's farmers to both succeed and advance soil conservation.
Hey, Jason, let's have a look at that field on the seed sink here.
Okay.
Today, nearly every North American farmer embraces the very latest advancements in science and computer technologies. That helps create not only higher yields and healthier topsoil, but also universal farming innovation.
If you're looking at micro mapping of the field, it's amazing the resolution that we can get now. That affects the drainage patterns. We get better crop growth, making sure that the plants are where the water is and making sure that they're not where there's too much water.
That's very important in being able to manage a land area precisely.
One quarter at a time, 1 acre at a time, 1 square foot at a time. Soils are that important for us to do those steps, to understand soils, to just do a better job.
By leveraging accurate weather data, as well as in-depth soil analysis, farmers now more than ever know what to expect both above their land and below it.
We have new technologies that are coming from companies that are developing weather stations that are directed towards field crops. So we're able to access information like how the soil is receiving the rain that is coming down.
We also have some soil nutrient analysis technologies that we're looking at that measure levels of the important nutrients in soil to give it its fertility and its plant supporting nature.
Seed developers have created seed strains and coatings that require less water and can survive ever more dramatic changes in temperature.
We select from between 50 and 80,000 different varieties every year, and we keep making progress. for better use of water, better use of fertilizers, resistance to drought, resistance to high temperatures.
Technology companies have developed computer programs to analyze huge amounts of agricultural data.
We use multiple year satellite imagery to understand what the levels of nutrients are in the soil. Then we fertilize based on what that crop needs so that we're not over-fertilizing or under-fertilizing in those fields.
This is the next evolution into the next phase of leveraging all of the data, communication systems, sensor systems, control systems into what we do now.
We are gathering every single piece of data you can imagine, from imagery to soil data, climate data, everything, to build a platform to allow us to optimize inputs like fertilizer and seed, and then manage the growth of that crop to optimize plant production.
Technology is changing in farming. What we're looking at is how do we make that more efficient, and how do we make more off the ground we already have? Because they're not making more soil, so we got to produce more off our land base. And that's what we're working towards with technology, is getting more off that land base.
Information, data, it's a good thing.
To put that data to use, an innovative farm equipment pioneer called CleanSeed has developed a planting and seeding machine called the Smart Seeder Max.
The biggest problem to solve in no-till systems is the seeding tool, is residue management and our ability to cut through last year's residue and place seed properly.
This machine uses data to make a single trip across the field, maximizing planting and seeding efficiency and minimizing its footprint.
It's designed to do more with less, basically produce crops with less inputs, putting them exactly where they need to be, and giving a farmer a higher return on his crops.
This technology will change food for the world because it requires less input, less seed, less fertilizer, and the harvest will be much greater. That's what it will do.
Unlike the moldboard plow, the Smart Seeder Max makes only the smallest opening in the topsoil, almost like poking a stick in the ground and closing it with your foot, and accurately places up to 5 different products at the same time on every square foot of the field.
When you're able to place nutrition beside the seed or away from the seed where it needs to go, and then you can micromanage those nutrients on every single 12 inches, every single foot, you can place it exactly where it needs to go.
This helps keep surface matter intact and the soil structure stable. It also helps to promote carbon sequestration, also known as carbon capture.
If you look at sequestering carbon, we can capture and store it in old abandoned mines if we want, but really we're standing on the biggest potential to store atmospheric carbon, because it's plant food. I mean, CO2 is plant food, so we can do a lot with it.
Beautiful bed. It's almost like sleeping in a pillow top bed. It's just tucked in there so nice.
If we can increase the organic matter content of the soil through good management, we can increase carbon storage, carbon sequestration. And that means more carbon in the soil, less carbon in the atmosphere as CO2 has a positive impact on the overall effect on climate and climate change.
But can the introduction of a single new implement reverse the forces of a problem as massive as the rapid depletion of the world's soil resource? The answer might be yes. After all, it was the introduction of a single invention, the moldboard plow, that first set us on our current course. If we were to develop an agriculture that had small economies of scale which enriched the land rather than depleted it, that brought sustainability to the world's farmers, then such a system might well sweep across the globe from the Great Plains to the Third World, and with it, turn back the advancing wastelands that threatens to someday starve us all. It may be that mankind will get a second chance to bring the land back from exhaustion, to build the soil up rather than let it slip away. To take a harvest from the land and at the same time make an investment in the ability of future generations to do the same. To use the wonderful engine of life beneath our feet. That such a movement might take place seems almost inevitable. But the greater question may be whether the new technology will be adopted on a global scale in time to avert the coming crisis in food production.
This is it. Start of something new that all farmers can be a part of.
Yeah.
Big time.
Yes.
I think you should care about this because we all have to eat. Without farmers, without crop production, we don't eat.